Class is in session. All right. I have said it. Praise God. So this morning I woke up and I'm just doing my morning routine and whatnot. And I go online and I'm checking some stuff on this social media website. And I see that a friend of mine posted something. I don't know if it was last night or this morning too, which said something that I don't agree with. And this is basically what his post said. God gives, but he also takes away. So don't get too attached to to the things that he gives you, because don't get too attached to things that you have, because they're not that important, because at one point he's going to take it away. So I'm reading that and I'm thinking, no, this guy's wrong. And I was going to post something back as a comment. Hey, here's an argument to destroy basically your statement. But it's nah, I'm not gonna do that. So when I was at work, I'm sitting at my desk and I'm checking some paperwork, and God starts speaking to me. And he's like, nope, you have to say something. And the scripture that I was gonna put this morning as a comment on this guy's post was the same scripture that came back to my mind when God was talking to me when I was at work. So I immediately started looking it up and all that. So I'm going to read it to you. And it's Romans chapter 11, verses 25 through 32. And I'm going to read it from a few translations. This is from the King James. For I would not, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery, lest ye should be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part has happened to Israel, until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in, and so all Israel shall be saved. As it is written, there shall come out of Zion the deliverer, and shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob. For this is my covenant unto them, when I shall take away their sins. As concerning the gospel, they are enemies for your sakes, but as touching the election, they are beloved for the Father's sake. For the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. For as ye in times past have not believed God, yet have now obtained mercy through their unbelief. Even so have these also now not believed, that through your mercy they also may obtain mercy. For God hath concluded them all in unbelief, that he might have mercy upon all. Now I'm going to read that from the Amplified Bible. Lest you be self-opinionated, wise in your own conceits. I do not want you to miss this hidden truth and mystery, brethren. A hardening insensibility has temporarily befallen a part of Israel to last until the full number of the ingathering of the Gentiles has come in. And so all Israel will be saved, as it is written, the deliverer will come from Zion. He will banish ungodliness from Jacob. And this will be my covenant, my agreement with them, when I shall take away their sins. From the point of view of the gospel, good news, they, the Jews at present, are enemies of God, which is for your advantage and benefit. But from the point of view of God's choice of election, of divine selection, they are still the beloved, dear to him, for the sake of their forefathers. For God's gifts and his call are irrevocable. He never withdraws them when once they are given, and he does not change his mind about those to whom he gives his grace or to whom he sends his call. Just as you were once disobedient and rebellious toward God, but now have obtained his mercy through their disobedience, so they also now are being disobedient when you are receiving mercy, that they in turn may one day, through the mercy you are enjoying, also receive mercy, that they may share the mercy which has been shown to you through you as messengers of the gospel to them. For God has consigned, penned up all men to disobedience, only that he may have mercy on them all alike. I'm going to read from the Message translation. I want to lay all this out on the table as clearly as I can, friends. This is complicated. It would be easy to misinterpret what's going on and arrogantly assume that you're royalty and they're just rabble out on their ears for God, for good. But that's not it at all. This hardness on the part of inside Israel toward God is temporary. Its effect is to open things up to all the outsiders so that we end up with a full house. Before it's all over, there will be a complete Israel, as it is written. A champion will stride down from the mountain of Zion. He'll clean house in Jacob. And this is my commitment to my people, removal of their sins. From your point of view, as you hear and embrace the good news of the Message, it looks like the Jews are God's enemies. But look at from the long-range perspective of God's overall purpose. They remain God's oldest friends. God's gifts and God's call are under full warranty, never canceled, never rescinded. There was a time not so long ago when you were on the outs with God, but then the Jews slammed the door on him and things opened up for you. Now they are on the outs, but with the door held wide open for you, they have a way back in. In one way or another, God makes sure that we all experience what it means to be outside so that he can personally open the door and welcome them back in. God takes stuff away, yes, but it's none of the gifts that he gives us. He takes away our sins. He takes away our pain, our suffering, our sickness, anything that is a product of this fallen world that we live in, or poor choices that we make. When we repent and go to him, he takes it away. But he will never take away any gift that he gives us. Right. Psalm 145, verse 9 says, "The Lord is good to all, and his mercy is over all that he has made." Psalm 100, verse 5, "For the Lord is good, his steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations." James chapter 1, verse 17 says, Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change." What is the greatest gift that God has given mankind? His only Son. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life." Why would God give you something that is going to bring you close to him to then take it away? Because it's bored? It's not going to do that. If someone wants to give you something as big as his only Son, so we, through him, can get close to him, that's just right there proof that he will never take anything away from you that he has given you. Amen. So, amen. That's what I wanted to share. So with that, I open the floor for questions. Why is the sky blue? Well, that's actually, no, I'm kidding. I can give you the scientific explanation.
There's a song that we used to sing, and I don't remember who it was, and I'm not trying to, I don't know who brought it up, but it was like a Matthew West song or something. He gives and takes away.
Yeah, that's Matt Ribbon.
Who is it?
Matt Ribbon.
Okay, so we quit singing it, right? Because it says that. Somebody said something about it one day.
I think I did.
Didn't somebody say something and then...
Oh, yeah, somebody did say something about it.
Okay, so I don't know the full lyrics to the song, but I have to believe...
Blessed be your name.
Yeah, blessed be
There's. Here's where I think it's coming from. I've seen a lot of people say, my mother-in-law, for example, she got a diagnosis a few weeks ago. She's complaining about it on Facebook. And someone says something to her, and she says, oh, you know, I'm not worried. God does not give us burdens that we cannot carry. No, that's an incorrect statement. Because whatever pain you're going through, suffering, emotional situation, financial situation, whatever, God is not testing you. He uses whatever situation comes from what's happening, because what's been carrying over since Adam says, yes, give me some of the apple, Eve, you know, happens in our lives. So another example, I was watching a TV show the other day. Something happened to this character, and she's crying, and her mom says, you have to remember this, honey. God created sin so he could show us his mercy. No, he didn't create sin. So I'm just sitting there. I've seen that show about 3 times already, the entire series. And this is the first time that I've actually noticed that line. And I'm like, no, this is wrong. But there's this collective mentality, you know, in mankind, that when bad things happen to us, and it's basically the Job mentality,
yeah.
Though he's might me, or he's mold me, or whatever the word is, I'll still, you know, praise him. I don't know how the scripture goes, but what did Job believe? That God gave him whatever he was going through. So a lot of people still think that way. And I think that's where it's coming from.
But the lesson of Job is just the opposite of that.
Yep.
Yeah.
It was the enemy that stole and killed and destroyed, and God gave him back.
Yep.
Threefold.
Right. His buddies
were
gone.
It wasn't God who took
those
first.
But people don't believe that. They or at least they choose not to believe it.
Well, religion teaches you,
yeah,
that God takes away, that God tests you and tries you and refines you.
I was talking to my brother yesterday, and I've never claimed that I know the Bible from the very first to the very last word, or that I know the name of every single book or anything. But, you know, over time, since I said, yes, Lord, I want you in my life, you know, he's been revealing things to me. And it's hard for people to see someone that is living according to the word. So I'm talking to my brother yesterday, and we're talking about my wife, Ariadna, and our situation. And he asked me this question. He says, so do you want to get back together with her? And I said, yes, because she's the woman that God chose for me. She's my soulmate. He's like, but I just don't understand, how can you be so calm in this whole situation? And I said, because when God reveals to you the truth that's in his word, like when Jesus said, I am the truth, you know, the only thing that you can do is just rest in him. And you have to be at peace, because there's no other way.
Right.
That's where that peace comes from. So, anyone want to say, John?
Yeah, I have a Hamlin called me and wanted to mention her for prayer for her body. She's getting up there where we're all headed, you know, like where it carries. So, takes a lot of strength to keep going, and that's what she needs, is more strength and abilities to move around. And one of these days, the Lord will bring her home, but until then, hopefully she can function to a level that's good, you know, and that's where she has to be institutionalized, put away, you know, like so many are.
Yeah.
He was, I tell you, Pastor said, you know, Moses and some of the others that just had their strength and Abraham.
Yeah.
Anyway, God can do that, and so we just need to pray for one another, because we're all in this together, and we're all equal parts of the same thing, the body of Christ. And lift each other up and thank God for the privilege of being called here. Amen.
Yeah. All right. Well, let's pray, but let's join hands and stand together.
And
James, come here.
For my wife, too.
Yeah.
She's doing much better today, so thank you, Jesus.
And what's this I heard about? Hula skirts?
Hula shirts.
Hula shirts.
Okay.
I thought you were talking about hula skirt. I'm like, no. Nobody wants to see Jan in a hula skirt.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
this is the real thing.
Well, we have the words, so we have cheat sheets.
Thank you. Yes, our voices unto you we raise. Let the river flow, let the river flow, let the river flow. Cause there is a river whose streams make glad the city of our God. So I will rejoice, I will rejoice, be glad.
Thank you. Thank you.
song of all songs. Praise the Lord.
Yes, we'll take another, Lord. when the waves are breaking and the sun is hard to find, when the deep is calling and the
Father, I elevate my prayer to you. Reveal yourself to those that don't know you. Show them your goodness, Lord. Reveal to them your true nature, Father, that you are a good God, that you give, that you don't take. You comfort us, but you don't make us sad. Father, show those that don't know you who you are so they can enter into your rest. Thank you.
When I look at the blood, all I see is love, love, love. When I stop at the cross, I can see the love of God. When I look at the blood, all I see is love, love, love. When I stop at the cross, I can see the love of God. Love, 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 love. When I stop at the cross, I can see the love of God. When I look at the blood, all I see is love, love, love. When I stop at the cross, I can see the love of God. But I can't see competition. I can't see hierarchy. I can't see pride or prejudice or abuse of authority. I can't see lust for power. I can't see manipulation. I can't see rage or anger or selfish ambition. Because when
And my first thought was, is that a jewel in our crown? But it wasn't a reward. That's a reward for your works. It's our inheritance from our Father that he gives us, and it's a revelation of who he is, a new facet, a new color, a new revelation of his grace. And each of us got different revelations, different gems, different colors. I saw rubies, I saw emeralds, I saw amethysts, I saw diamonds. All of us, different colors, different revelations of who he is and his grace.
Glory.
As an inheritance, not a reward, not a reward for your works, but as inheritance.
Hallelujah.
From our Father who store up all the riches in heaven.
Glory.
Jesus.
Glory. Glory. Just like that.
Just like the robe.
Mm-hmm.
The prodigal son and the ring.
Yeah.
The ring. It was in his inheritance.
Well, there's like a cloud that descended and it just dropped a jewel.
Finished. And you know, we're not ate up over the numbers games just for the sake of having more people here, but you know, I'd like to see people come that just don't have a clue, you know, and but yet have questions and have, you know, I believe wholeheartedly this is an extremely inviting place, more so inviting than any other body that I've ever been a part of, because it's from A to Z. I mean, it's all across the board. So this is an extremely inviting place, and you know, I believe wholeheartedly that you know, as we continue to grow and suffer the growing pains, you know, with one hand you see, well, how long does it take to
drum solo pick up his voice.